with this, we have completed an overview of the provisions of the DNC Act and rules as far as the manufacture of drugs for the purpose of sale is concerned. Once a pharma organization has obtained a license to manufacture the drug, he can manufacture it, but he still cannot sell it because he does not have a license for sale of drugs. Therefore, in the forthcoming slides, I will discuss with you the procedure involved in and the licenses required for selling of drugs. So let us move forward to understand the prospects of sale of drugs. What are the forms? What are the applications? What is the procedure? So it is again divided into sale of drugs other than homeopathic medicines and sale of homeopathic medicines. The state government, so this comes, sale comes under the purview of the state government, shall appoint licensing authorities for this purpose, that is issuing license for sale of drugs. Applications for the grant of license or renewal of a license to sell, stock, exhibit or offer for sale or distribute drugs other than those included in Schedule X, that is narcotics and psychotropic drugs, shall be made in Form 19 accompanied by a fee of rupees 1,500. Or Form 19A with a fee of 500 as the case may be, or in case of drugs that are included in Schedule X, the application shall be made in Form 19C accompanied by a fee of rupees 500. Provided that in case of a vendor who desires to establish a shop in a village or a town having a population of 5,000 or less, the application in Form 19A shall be accompanied by a fee of rupees 10. So, in order to motivate businesses, in order to motivate pharmacies to open up, to manufacturing to be set up at locations which are remote throughout the country, the fees is less. What about the forms of licenses to sell drugs? A license to sell, stock, exhibit or offer for sale or distribute drugs other than those specified in Schedule C, C1 and X and by retail on restricted license or by wholesale shall be issued in Form 20 to Form 20A or Form 20B as the case may be. So the application is made in Form 9 or 9A or 9B, whereas the license is obtained in Form 20, Form 20A or Form 20B. If the drugs are to be sold or stocked for sale at more than one location, then separate applications are made for each location and separate licenses shall be issued for each of such places. Thus, this is a summary of the forms in which applications are made for obtaining license to sell from the licensing authorities. So this is a revision of what I just taught you in the last three slides. If a person wishes to have a retail or wholesale of drugs other than Schedule X, then he or she should apply in Form 19. If restricted license for required for sale of drugs belonging to Schedule X, then Form 19A is the application form. If a wholesaler license is required, then application should be made in Form 19AA. Whereas for sale of drugs belonging to Schedule X, the form for application for license is Form 19C. And the licenses for these are obtained in forms 20, 20A, 20B and 20BB for all drugs other than Schedule C, C1 and X. For drugs that are specified in Schedule C and C1, the licenses are given in the forms 21, 21A, 21B and 21BB. For drugs that are specified in Schedule X, so the narcotic and psychotropic drugs, they can be sold only by retail or wholesale, and this is done by and the license that is given is in form 20F or 20G. So there are specific forms for application for license to sell or stock for sale, which I explained to you on the previous slide in a summary, and the license is obtained in form of either 20, 21 or 20s, which is given here. For more details about the license to sell, you can refer the DNC Act and read for yourself about the forms, different forms in which application is to be made and the different forms in which the license is obtained. Format of all these licenses is also included in the supplementary part of the DNC Act and rules, which you can refer. Moving forward, what are the, so once the license is application for license is made, the inspection will be carried out, and what are the conditions meant to be complied with for grant of license is what we will see next. A license in form 20A or 21A shall not be granted to any person unless the licensing authority is satisfied that the premises are adequate and equipped with proper storage and space accommodation for preserving the properties of the drugs to which the license applies. So, inspection for ensuring that appropriate storage space is available is carried out by the under the guidance instructions of the licensing authorities. Also taken into consideration is how many licenses to sell have been granted in that particular locality during the past 1 year, as well as the occupation or trade or business that is carried out by the applicant. Once obtained, the license, whether it is 20A or 21A or 20, 21, 20B, 21B, 20F, 20BB or 21BB, the license once obtained enter in any of these forms should be prominently displayed on the premises from where the sale is going to take place. Next time, whenever you go to a chemist shop, look around and you will see the license being displayed prominently. Read which license has been obtained by him. How many licenses have been obtained by the pharmacist? The shop, the premise shall comply with the provisions of the DNC Act and rules. No drug should be sold unless purchased under cash or credit memo from a licensed dealer or manufacturer. So the shopkeeper, the pharmacist or the chemist should buy his stocks from a licensed dealer or manufacturer. Who is a licensed manufacturer? We have just seen in our previous few slides. The chemist has to buy his stocks from a licensed manufacturer. He should himself display his license for sale in a prominent place. The licensee shall inform the licensing authorities about any change in the constitution of his firm which is operating under the license to sell. The licensee having a license in any particular form, let us say he is having a license in form 20A, then he shall deal only with those drugs which can be sold under license under form 20A, that is without supervision, that is other than C, C1 and X. So if he wants to sell narcotics and psychotropic drugs, he should have the appropriate license. He cannot sell it under Form 20A license. The premises from where sale is carried out should be in charge of a competent person who is a registered pharmacist. So this is the importance of registration. Once you have completed your B-Pharm, you become a registered pharmacist who is authorized to sell drugs. The license is given only on the assurance of the presence of a registered pharmacist in the premises. Records of sale and purchase should be maintained, and such records should be preserved for 3 years from the date of sale. The licensee shall report to license authorities any change in the qualified staff in charge within a month of such a change occurring. Also, the licensee shall maintain an inspection book in Form 35 to enable the inspector to record his impression as well as any deficiencies that have been noticed. No drug shall be sold or stopped by the licensee after the date of expiration of potency recorded on its container, label or wrapper, or in violation of any statement or direction recorded on such a container, label or wrapper. Now, what does this mean? If you see the label of any product, you will see a manufacturing date and a expiry date. If the expiry of the product as mentioned on the label is May 2021, then the pharmacist can sell it till 31st of May of 2021. However, he cannot sell it after that. Neither can he stop it. So, no drug shall be sold or even stopped by the licensee beyond the date of expiry, or if the such a product has been stored in a way that is against the storage instructions, then he should not be selling it. So if the product is meant to be refrigerated and the pharmacist does not refrigerate it, but he keeps it outside at room temperature, he should not be selling it. Next, no drug intended for distribution to the medical profession as a free sample and no drug meant for consumption by the ESIC, the Central Government Health Scheme, or the government medical stores, depots, the armed force medical stores, or other government institutions which bears a distinguishing mark or any inscription on the drug or on the label affixed to the container thereof indicating this purpose shall be sold or stocked by the licensee on his premises. All of you must be aware of the term physician's sample. There are certain samples that are given by the company to the doctors through their medical representatives, and such samples are called as physician's samples. On the label of the container or on the label that is present on the carton of these products, you will find the words for physician sample only, not to be sold. Such stocks which are meant for physicians should not find their way into the saleable stocks. Similarly, there are some stocks that are procured by the government, such as for the through their central government scheme, or for the government medical stores, or for the armed forces medical stores, etc., which again are at a subsidized rate or probably free samples, but meant for distribution only to people through these particular stores. They are not meant for sale to the general public, and therefore such stocks also should not be found in the premises of a licensed chemist who is selling the drugs at a retail to the general public. Some additional information that must be furnished for by an applicant for license to sell includes: the applicant for grant of license shall, on demand, furnish to the licensing authority before the grant of license or during the period that the license is in force, as the case may be, documentary evidence in respect of the ownership of occupation or rental or other basis of the premises specified in the application for the license or in the license granted, the constitution of the firm or any other relevant matter which may be required for the purpose of verifying the correctness of the statements made by the applicant or the licensee. Now, what this sentence tells us is that if I, as a pharmacist, wish to apply for a license to sell the drugs or cosmetics, I need to have my premises, either my own or rented, or other suitable places from where I will be making the sale. I cannot do so from my house, right? This is not something, this activity cannot be carried out from residential premises, commercial premises on ownership basis or rental basis or some other suitable arrangement for a premise that will be used exclusively for sale should be proven to the licensing authorities either before the grant of license or any time during the tenure of the license, that is as long as the license is valid, and upon demand. If the licensing authority so demands, then for particulars of the premise being used exclusively for sale of drugs and being either ownership or rented or otherwise should be furnished and should prove clearly without any doubt that the premise is exclusively being used for sale of drugs. Once the license is granted, it is valid for a period of 5 years, and before expiry of the license, it should be renewed. But there are special instances where the license may be either cancelled or suspended, and that is what we are going to look at. The licensing authority may, after giving the licensee an opportunity to show cause why such an order should not be passed, by an order in writing stating the reasons therefore, cancel a license issued under this part or suspend it for such a period as he thinks fit, either wholly or in respect of some of the substances to which it relates, if in his opinion, that is the opinion of the licensing authority, the licensee has failed to comply with any of the conditions of the license or with any of the provisions of the DNC Act or the rules. If the licensing authority feels that some of the terms and conditions that were given under the license or under the provision of the DNC Act and rules or certain specific provisions with respect to the drugs that are being sold are not complied with, the licensing authority may issue a show cause notice. And thereafter, if no satisfactory explanation is provided, either suspend the license to sell or cancel the license to sell. Okay, that is why it is very important to comply with all the rules, regulations,
terms and conditions, employ appropriate staff, make sure that the storage conditions and other restrictions are complied with, and ensure that no drug that has been expired is sold, no drug which is a physician sample or belonging to armed force medical stores is sold in the general stores, etc. All these terms and conditions which we have been seeing so far should be complied with. Otherwise, if they are contravened, that is not followed, then the licensing authority may issue show cause notice and either suspend the license to sell or cancel the license to sale. The repercussions of this would be huge financial loss and loss of integrity of the licensee. In case where the licensing authority decides to cancel the license, then what will the pharmacist do with the huge stocks that he has? There is a procedure for disposing of these stocks in the event of cancellation of license. So what we are going to look at next is the procedure for disposal of drugs in the event of cancellation of license. In case a licensee whose license has been cancelled desires to dispose of the drugs he has in his possession, he shall apply in writing to the licensing authority for this purpose, and in his application he will give the following details. So the procedure for getting rid of the stocks that are present with the licensee in case of his license cancellation is, he will first write an application to the licensing authority in which he will write down the particulars, the name and address of the person to whom the drugs are proposed to be sold or supplied, together with the number of the license for sale or manufacture as the case may be, names of the drugs together with their quantities, batch numbers, names and addresses of the manufacturers, dates of expiry, if any, that are proposed to be sold to the person. So there are two things which are important. One is the name, address and details of the person to whom he proposes to sell the drugs, and all details about those drugs which he proposes to sell, whether it is their name, quantity, batch number, manufacturing address, date of expiry, etc. The licensing authority may, after examination and inspection by an inspector of the drugs, grant the necessary permission for their disposal. So the application is evaluated, the drugs are assessed, and the premise where the drugs are stocked is checked to make sure that the drug has not degraded, and then permission for disposal is granted to the licensee whose license has been cancelled. Once applied for, how long is the license valid? An original license, that is first time application, or a renewed license to sell the drugs is normally valid for a period of 5 years from the date on which it has been granted or renewed, unless it is suspended or cancelled. So, license is granted for a period of 5 years from the date of issue of the license. Before the 5 years ends, it should be renewed. Under unusual circumstances, the license may be suspended or cancelled. We will now look at the power of the central government to prohibit manufacture, sale of drugs and cosmetics in public interest without prejudice to any other provision that is contained in this chapter. If the central government is satisfied that the use of any drug or cosmetic is likely to involve risk to human beings or animals, or that any drug that does not have therapeutic value that it is claiming to have or contains ingredients and in such a quantity for which there is no therapeutic justification, then in the public interest, it is necessary to do so that the government, by notification in the official gazette, will prohibit the manufacture, sale or distribution of such a drug or cosmetic. So to tell you in very simple words, the government, the central government, has the power to ban any drug or cosmetic for reasons that are stated in this slide, including that a risk is involved to human beings or animals, or the product does not have any therapeutic value, or the product is harmful to the general public. Now, what are the penalties for manufacture, sale, etc. of drugs in contravention of this chapter? So far, we have seen a number of rules, regulations, conditions that have to be satisfied by the applicant who is applying for license to manufacture or license to sell. After obtaining the license, if the licensee does not maintain the same terms and conditions or does not comply with the laid down specifications, then the licensee will be penalized. So what we are going to look at in this chapter is the penalty for manufacture or sale or distribution, etc. of drugs in contravention of this chapter. Whoever manufactures for sale or for distribution or sells or stocks or exhibits or offers for sale or distributes any drug deemed to be adulterated or which, when used by any person for or in the diagnosis, treatment, mitigation or prevention of any disease or disorder, is likely to cause his death or is likely to cause such harm on his body as would amount to grievous hurt, solely on account of the drug being adulterated or spurious or not of standard quality, then such an offense is punishable with imprisonment for a term that shall not be less than 5 years, but which may extend to a term of life, and with a fine which shall not be less than 10,000 rupees. So it is a very serious offense to manufacture, sell, stock or exhibit the drug which is either adulterated or which causes harm or which cannot be used in the diagnosis, treatment, mitigation or prevention, and use of which may cause death or grievous or serious harm to the body because it is adulterated or spurious, then remember, the penalty is very, very strong. It is a minimum of 5 years imprisonment going up to a lifetime of imprisonment and penalty of not less than 10,000 rupees. So it's a very serious matter to play with the life of the patient and therefore dealt with very seriously under the DNC Act and rules. In case of less serious offenses, such as a drug that is deemed to be adulterated or a drug without a valid license, such a crime is punishable with imprisonment for 1 to 3 years and with a fine which is not less than 5,000 rupees, provided, and this is an exception, that the court may, for any reason that is adequate or special that is recorded, impose a sentence of imprisonment for a term of less than 1 year and a fine of less than 5,000 rupees. So certain penalties are less severe depending on the severity of the contravention. So if the drug is adulterated but not necessarily harmful to human life or animal life, or if the license is invalid, it has not been renewed in time, etc., Then for such a case, the penalty is 1 to 3 years imprisonment and a fine of not less than 5,000 rupees. In special cases, the penalty may be even lower. Any drug deemed to be spurious shall be punishable with imprisonment for a term of 3 to 5 years and with a fine that is not less than 5,000 rupees. Any drug other than a drug referred to the above clauses shall be punishable with imprisonment for 1 to 2 years and with a fine. Similarly, penalty for non-disclosure of the name of the manufacturer or any other similar offense shall be punishable with imprisonment for up to 1 year or with fine up to 1,000 rupees or with both. The penalty for not keeping the documents updated and for non-disclosure of information is imprisonment up to 1 year and a fine up to rupees 1,000 or both. The report of analysis of the sample that was taken by the drug inspector and submitted to the government analyst for analysis is a confidential document. And the results that are expressed in those reports are shared with the licensee. However, the licensee cannot share these details of the test result with the general public. If he does so, then there is a penalty. So, what is the penalty for use of government analyst report as a means of advertising is that whoever uses the report of test or analysis that is generated by the Central Drugs Laboratory or by the government analyst, whether he uses the full report or any extract from such a report as a means of advertising either drug or cosmetic, then the licensee shall be punishable with fine, which may extend to 500 rupees. So the government analyst report may mention that the product is of standard quality. However, this is a confidential report and the report cannot be used as a means of advertising about the quality of their goods. Thus, the licensee has no rights to use or rather misuse the government analyst report. If he does so, then it is punishable with fine, which may be up to 500 rupees. Whenever a licensee has not complied with the terms and conditions laid down and he or she is convicted under this chapter, that is penalized under this chapter, then his stocks are liable to be confiscated. Okay, so where any person has been convicted under this chapter, that is found guilty, the stock of the drug or cosmetic in respect of which the contravention has been made shall be liable to confiscation. So if there is a particular batch of tablets which is not complying with the restrictions and terms and conditions, then the whole batch can be confiscated. If the batch is deemed to be misbranded, adulterated or spurious, manufacture for sale or distribution, sale or stocking or exhibiting or offering for sale or distribution of any drug without a valid license also makes the product likely to be confiscated. So the stocks from the licensee may be confiscated if the drug is misbranded, adulterated or spurious or being manufactured or sold or distributed without a valid license. So having a license and that too valid is very, very important. Otherwise, the stocks are likely to be confiscated.